who've organized such a good conference. It's been wonderful. I think the team in Germany are amazing. I think Holger does a great job. Sorry, Holger, I can't read your handwriting here. What does it say? I think Holger is the best in all of Germany. Is that, I read that okay, Holger? Now, let me make sure. I'm going to just say, wait one more minute to let people in. Let me see here. Yeah, okay. So on the chat, when you are ready, the German team can tell me when they want to kick off. We have some funky music while we wait. Hey, there's Martin. Shout out to Martin. Give us a wave, Martin. And I'll give you a 10-second countdown. We're ready to go, so you can start streaming. Martin is a genius of a man who looks after all of our web streaming and our TV broadcasts, and he wears a cap like he's from Brooklyn in New York City. He's wearing a cap for the sun even though he's indoors, because sometimes the light from those monitors can be very strong and you got to keep your eyes shaded from it. Okay, I think we're almost ready to go, so we'll kick off proceedings. Welcome everyone to this session. There's our little welcome video. Look at that. This is our next session. It's called Greenwash or Circular Economy. That is what this session is about here at the Let's Do It World Conference, brought to you by everyone working together, but mainly Let's Do It World, who are based in Tallinn, Estonia. Let's Do It Germany, who are the hosts of this year's event. And of course, Let's Do It Indonesia, who have been really helping out as well. So everyone working together to bring you this virtual conference. And I think so far we've been having a good time. Have we not, everybody? Give me a thumbs up if you agree. If you don't agree, Laura, I'm going to call you out. Why aren't you giving me a thumbs up? Come on, there we go. She's having a good time. Everyone's having a good time. Let me see who else have we got in the house here. Yes, we have a rapper from yesterday, Vincenzo, of course, from Italy. Chris, you're in a car or you're in a plane? Where are you?
I'm in a car in the rain in Costa Rica, so I hope you guys can hear me.
We spoke before we did an interview and your dog kept barking in the background and you were shouting at it like a lunatic. Do you remember?
Yes, I did.
We'll be hearing from you later. Who else have we got here before we kick off? We've got to say hi to some people. Is that Jim? Look, we've Jim. Hey, Jim, how are you?
Fine.
Thank you for your enthusiasm, Jim.
I'm going Estonian male and speaking less.
Don't knock us over now with your joy and enthusiasm for this. But we like your backdrop, your fairy lights, very festive. You're keeping them up all year round?
Absolutely.
Okay, very good. Tomas is here from Iceland. Nina. Hi, Nina.
Hello.
Oh. How are you?
Good, good.
You're like a saint. You have a light above your head, like a halo.
Yes.
Like it looks like you've just had a good idea.
Well, maybe I did.
What's the good idea?
What's the idea? Well, as you might also be able to see in my background, I received some balloons today from some of my very good friends who are missing me in these corona times. And so maybe that's the idea to bring forward to other people, because that really touched me. So if there's someone you miss, send them balloons. It's a great hit.
So good. But Nina, they are love heart balloons.
I know. But they are for my girlfriends.
Can I point out, Nina, that behind me you will see no love heart balloons? And I could move the camera. There's none in here. So if anyone wants to send love heart balloons to Cullum in Rome, silence.
I'm sure I can spare one.
Thank you. Thank you for the sympathy. I appreciate that. Let's say hello to one person before we get underway. Everyone's in the house. I want to pick on someone who doesn't have their camera on, because one of the rules of this is that you must have your camera on because we want to see each other. Let's go, Fabio. Fabio, I like your picture. You're like this. You look very thoughtful with your glasses. Turn on your camera and microphone.
Thank you, Colm. This is a picture from last year from the conference.
Oh, is that what, that's from the after party. Do the pose there. Show me how you do it because you look very smart. Do it.
Yeah, I'm thinking it and I'm concentrating and also listening to this very interesting conversation.
Actually, you know what? I'm making fun of you for doing that and trying to make it look interesting. If I turn off my video, you'll see my, look at that. Come on.
It's almost the same.
It's almost the same. Hang on. Yeah, turn off yours as well. There we go. We could be brothers.
Yes, it could be. Thank you.
Fabio, thank you so much. Colm, stop talking nonsense and get things underway. It is good to have you all here. It's great to talk to you all. I could talk to you all day and see all the faces from around the world. But there are much more interesting people who are here to talk to you. And we're talking about in the session, as I mentioned, greenwash or circular economy. And our first speaker today is going to be our friend Sybil. Sybil Bullock from the United States of America. And the question that she is posing, who are the biggest polluters of 2020? Break free from plastics, brand audit the results. So they did this audit. She has the results. She is going to name and shame. Sybil, we love you. We miss you. And it's over to you.
Hi, Colm. Hi, everyone. It's so good to see you. I miss you. It was so great to have an in-person conference last year, just before everything changed. But thanks so much for organizing this virtually. It's the next best thing, and it's so nice to be here with all of you. Okay, so let me kick things off and share my screen. One second.
Sybil on her balcony. Are you on your balcony or inside? Your background is confusing me.
Oh, it is too cold to be outside. It's a sunroom, so it's primarily windows, but I'm inside. It's still a little chilly though, which is why I have a big sweater on.
Well, we're looking forward to our presentation. Take it away.
Great. Can you all see my screen?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, great. So as Colm mentioned, I'm here representing the Break Free from Plastic movement. We're a global movement envisioning a future free from plastic pollution. And my role in the movement is to coordinate our brand audit initiative. So before we get started, just a few things about Break Free from Plastic in case you haven't heard of us before. We are made up of about 11,000 organizations and individuals from all over the world. Many folks from the movement I see are here in this session today and are part of the Let's Do It World movement as well. And what we really are trying to do is demand massive reductions in single-use plastics and to push for lasting solutions to the plastic pollution crisis. And together we share the common values of environmental protection and social justice, and we work together through a holistic approach to bring systemic change under our core pillars. And so what that means for us is really tackling plastic pollution across the whole plastics value chain, from the extraction of the raw materials of fossil fuels that make plastic all the way to waste and disposal at the end. And so we really want to focus on prevention rather than cure, and that really informs our whole work. So what I'm very excited to present to you all today is the results of our annual brand audit initiative. This is the title of our report, and I will be more than happy to share the links to all the resources I'll talk about in the chat at the end of the presentation. So this is our third year doing an annual brand audit in which hundreds of thousands of people all over the world get involved and make a really big impact together. So I'll tell you a little bit about what this project is about and what we learned in this year's brand audit. And this is the title of our report this year, Branded Volume 3, Demanding Corporate Accountability for Plastic Pollution. So what exactly is a brand audit, you might be thinking? So the way this all started was when the Breakthrough from Plastic movement was founded in 2016, our members around the world vowed to mobilize around a common mission to massively reduce single-use plastics at the source. And so the development of brand audits came from this initial idea, and it has emerged and developed into a citizen science initiative to record and expose the names of the companies that are producing the plastic waste that trash our communities worldwide. And so they're our way of really gathering the evidence that we need to hold those companies accountable and demand lasting change. So how do we do this exactly? It's really a combination of civic action and citizen science. So we use the standard methodology and hold trainings for everyone. So what we are really asking groups to do is similar to what you all know how to do extremely well, is organizing these community cleanup actions and events, but we take it a step further and actually record data on the waste that we're finding. And one of the key pieces of data that we want to record is the brand information of the trash that you're finding, so that we're really shifting the focus of accountability away from individuals who litter and towards the original source of the problem, who are the companies who produce this unmanageable single-use plastic waste in the first place. It's important to point out that these brand audits are carried out across all environments where you can find plastic waste. So not just beaches, not just parks, but literally anywhere where you can find plastic waste is a place where you can conduct a brand audit. And so this allows us to expose exactly who's responsible for the plastic pollution and better hold them accountable to solve it. So this year, almost 15,000 volunteers across 6 continents in 55 countries took part in 575 brand audits. These audits involved more than 200 participating organizations around the world. Huge thank you to all the Let's Do It World groups who are among those who organized brand audits in their communities. And I want to say it's especially remarkable that this year, despite the extremely difficult circumstances of the coronavirus pandemic, we actually saw more events in more countries than ever before in the 4 years that Breakthrough from Plastic has been around and has led this initiative. So this is a project that is resilient in the face of pandemics. So huge thank you to all those who made it possible. So what exactly did we find? Well, if you're familiar with last year's top polluters, you might notice that this year's top polluters are basically exactly the same. You can see our top three, Coke, Pepsi, and Nestle, have been the exact same top three polluters for 3 years in a row. And 7 of our top polluters on this list, the Coca-Cola Company, PepsiCo, Nestle, Unilever, Mondelez International, Mars, and Colgate, 7 of those of the companies I just named have actually joined what you might all be familiar with, the New Plastics Economy Global Commitment, which is an initiative holding big companies accountable and helping them to improve their sustainability initiatives through voluntary commitments. But unfortunately, this is clearly not enough. According to a recent Ellen MacArthur report, the signatories to this New Plastic Economy Global Commitment have only reduced their use of virgin plastic by 0.1% from 2018 to 2019. And this is indeed reaffirmed in the excellent new report. Just want to give a quick pitch to this from the Changing Markets Foundation called Talking Trash, which actually looked at our top 10 polluters from the Brand Audit Report and looked at the industry tactics to distract, delay, and derail legislation that's being used by corporations and industry associations in countries around the world. So it has a number of fascinating case studies that show that companies have used their voluntary initiatives, such as commitments to recycling and ocean cleanups, as a tactic to distract consumers and governments, while behind the scenes, they vigorously lobby to delay and derail ambitious legislation. So I really encourage folks to check this out. I'll share the link in the chat at the end of this presentation. So just interesting to kind of have some context for what these top polluters are doing when we call them out for being top polluters. So what kind of items did we find? The top most common product types were, to nobody's surprise, food packaging, smoking materials such as cigarette butts. Folks in this group are surely no stranger to the shocking amount of cigarette butts that are made out of a type of plastic, and household products. The most common types of items sync up perfectly well with these types of products. They are sachets, so it was really small, single-serve packaging, such as a ketchup packet. If you imagine at a fast food chain, for example, these sorts of multi-layer packages, and again, cigarette butts and bottles. Sachets are extremely problematic as a waste material to process, impossible to recycle, and we saw about 10,000 more sachets reported this year than last year. Of course, everyone wants to know what kind of COVID-related waste we might have found. So this is what was recorded by our participants around the world. 770 single-use surgical masks, which are primarily made of polypropylene, a type of plastic, and 419 single-use surgical gloves, which can be made out of a few different materials, typically latex, vinyl, or nitrile. Two of those are types of plastic, and latex is a natural rubber. So there you have it. And to kind of look at trends over time, since we started the global brand audits in 2018, again, these have been the consistent top three polluters. And you can see not only is the amount of plastic we're recording from each of those countries increasing, but the number of countries in which we find these waste items are also increasing. So that's the way we calculate the top polluter, is the number of countries in which we find them and the number of total items recorded with that brand name. So it's pretty pretty stark to kind of see this growth continue. What we did differently this year is we worked really closely with waste picker groups around the world. So in seven different countries, Brazil, Chile, Ghana, India, the Philippines, Vietnam, and South Africa, we coordinated and collaborated with these groups to do brand audits with waste pickers. Because while some of us, like folks in this conference, of course, pick up waste in our free time as a community action, as a civic duty, others do so for survival to earn a living. And we have a lot to learn from them. So this is showing the results of how much of the waste they collected is actually recyclable. And you can see barely more than half in most cases. And this is from the experts who really know their stuff. Like, they earn a living from what's recyclable, so they can really tell us. And we learned a lot from these waste picker brand audits this year. We also recorded how much these recyclables are worth. There's often this narrative that recycling in the global south is a big job creator. But you can see that when it comes to plastic, the income that they earn from plastic compared to metal or other materials is very, very low. But I'm actually really excited to stop talking and actually show you and turn over the mic to the waste pickers themselves, because as much as the numbers and charts can tell us a lot, so do the stories of the waste pickers and their lived experiences. So closing quote from Simon, who is an amazing speaker, speaks 11 languages, all 11 languages, most common in South Africa, and he's the national coordinator of the South African Waste Picker Association. He says the majority of the plastic that we come across is not recyclable, and whatever cannot be recycled must not be produced. So with that being said, I will finish my presentation with a short film that we created with Break Free from Plastic and the waste picker groups in these seven countries. So allow me to just switch tabs here so I can show you. And let me make sure that I share my sound. Yes. Okay, perfect.
Sybil, we're seeing your desktop instead.
I'm sorry?
We're seeing your desktop instead.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And that looks amazing, wherever that is. We all want to go there.
Isn't it beautiful? It's in Tunis.
That's where Sybil lives, everybody. That's her third house is there.
Oh, I wish. I used to live there, actually. Okay, let's see if this is better. Are you seeing the video?
Yes, we can see it now. Yeah.
Oh, thank goodness. Thank you. Sorry about that. Okay, here we go.
We are waste pickers. What we do is to pick the recyclable materials for reuse.
I'm a waste picker and I'm in this waste picking business for the past 10 years.
Sou catadora, tenho 4 filhos, trabalho em cooperativa desde 2010.
Cheiro bem sujo hote, an mala bem changla maja, mana la bem wat.
Công mình xin cổ cái nhà luôn, à thế ạ.
Ngayon ang ginagawa ko po tuwing umaga, tuwing nahakot na po namin ng basura, pagising ko sa umaga, kukunin ko po yung kariton.
Tara pushta kaadte bazula, main kaadte bazula, fuga kaadte, RS kaadte. बिस्लेरी बाटली काढते काही चिलमिलीचे डबडे असतात काही मोड असते थोडंफार काय येतं वायरचा तुकडा बिकडा काय मग ते सगळं मला काढता येतं का तर त्याचे 2 पैसे मला येतात म्हणून मी ते सगळं काढते.
We supply to manufacturing companies. But looking at our system now, people are using materials who have no value.
बाकीचा जे कचरा आहे दुसरा जे नाही घेणारा ते मस जास्त निघतो मालापेक्षा बी जास्त निघतो हागीस थर्माकोल हे असले पाकिट कुरकुऱ्याचे कागद ही काही सुद्धा जात नाहीये. मोठ्या कंपन्या म्हणतात की छोटे पाकिट की आम्ही सांगितलेत म्हणून ती विकतात आम्हाला या अशी. तर ही जर काढायचं म्हणलं तर ती परवडलं पाहिजे आम्हाला बी. जर त्या ह्याला जर घेतलं तरी बी परवडन पण याला काय 2 पैसे बी येत नाहीत तरी काढून उपयोगाचंच नाही आहे मला काहीच उपयोगाचं नाही आहे कष्ट माझं घालून. या असल्या पाकिटाने काय होणार आहे ना काय नाही उगं फुकट कचरा व्हायची बारे ती घरात बी आणि चंबरात बी. ते मोठ्या कंपन्या किसे भरायचं काम आहे.
Uma covardia, uma grande empresa. Colocar um produto no mercado e não ter responsabilidade sobre ele.
The Break Free from Plastic Network globally does an annual brand audit. Communities and NGOs are taking the waste, collecting it, then they sort all of the waste according to the types of plastic, and then they do records of which brands they've seen. And once they have all of these tallies, they see who the biggest polluters are. You'll see all the same culprits year in and year out. And that's what's really sad. It's really a tragic part of the waste issue because we have all of these multinational corporations that are constantly being shown as the biggest polluters when it comes to plastic waste. And yet they haven't really shown any real commitment or any concrete steps towards phasing out single-use plastics. We have to ask corporations to commit to a reduction or a phase out of single-use plastic packaging and disposables and to explore and implement alternative delivery systems. We have reuse and refill models that are working all over the world. Corporations have to take responsibility for the waste that they're producing. In a fair and just society,
nobody gets left behind.
We depend on this work for survival. And our families are depending solely on this work that we are doing.
We are environmental workers. We need to be compensated.
Thanks, everyone. So to close out, these are our main demands to the corporations, that they reveal their total plastic footprint, reduce that footprint, and reinvent their packaging with alternative systems like reuse and refill. Thanks so much.
Good job, Sybil. Big round of applause, everyone, for Sybil. The crowd go wild for Sybil and her many homes dotted around the world. Great videos. Before we move on to the next speaker, because we're going to keep things going so we stay tonight, does anyone have a question for Sybil on her presentation? You can unmute your microphone, tell us your name and where you're from if you'd like to ask Sybil a question. Anyone like to ask Sybil a question? We have some back. Yes.
Question too. Okay, sorry for having kept my camera off, but the connection is so bad that I just had problems. Okay, your presentation made me think of an example that I noticed in Munich with waste caused by specific global corporations, because there's one McDonald's on the border of Munich, and several hundred meters around it, you can see like all the McDonald's trash. And to my knowledge, except for the lids of their disposable cups, the material is mainly paper, not even single-use plastics. And they set up a specific waste bins that are not belonging to the city of Munich, but just to McDonald's. So the waste bins are not even full, but the waste is lying around it. So I was wondering, in such a case where it's not even about the material, because most is paper, I think, but about like the behavior associated with using the products of the company. So what would you recommend to McDonald's, for example, how to tackle this problem? That like they provide waste bins and like recyclable material, but people are not using it properly.
Thanks for your question. It's difficult to keep this short since I know we have other speakers and I don't want to take up too much time, but the difficult thing with McDonald's and other big fast food companies is they have so many problems to be tackling, to be honest. While it's great that they're setting up receptacles, the problem with the single-use model is it's just not manageable. Like, we can do our very best, but the amount of, of single-use products that they're pumping out is just astronomical numbers that are difficult to maintain in any way that's remotely manageable. So things overflowing from small receptacles are kind of understandable when we're looking at the huge amounts that they're generating. McDonald's did have a recent positive change in that they accepted to phase out PFAS chemicals, like a toxic chemical that lines some of their packaging. It is worth just pointing out briefly, when you say the paper cups, a lot of the paper products are lined with plastic. But anyway, not to go into too many details. There's a lot of, pilot projects and things like that, but we're not really seeing anything at a large scale that shows enough robust commitment to making a systemic change at the source. But would love to keep talking with you offline. I'll share my email and would love to chat more.
Sybil, thank you so much. And Regina, thank you for that great question. I believe you're in Munich, but the background doesn't look like you're in Munich, but Munich's much more beautiful than I thought. Look at it, gorgeous. We're going to keep going to our next speaker. Speaking of gorgeous places, we're heading to Costa Rica now, and we're saying hello to Christine Figgener, and she'll be talking about holding large companies responsible, the power of individual consumers. Christine, it is over to you.
Yeah, hello everyone. I'm a marine biologist turned activist. I'm super excited to talk something that's so near and dear to my heart. I have been active with Footprint Foundation for a while now, where I'm leading their educational efforts. And Footprint Foundation is a nonprofit that is connected to a material engineering company that is developing genuine plastic-free as well as scalable and cost-effective food packaging. So for example, for the likes like McDonald's, so they won't have an excuse in future to say there is no such a thing as a plastic-free alternative. But in the meantime, can we go to the next slide, Holger? Awesome, yeah. So Sybil already talked about that. I think we all know those major polluters, and I think we are probably all having used some of their products at one point in our lives. And so we are very well familiar with, I think, most of what they're producing. And sometimes it's really difficult to get around those large companies and their products, especially if I'm talking about a country like Costa Rica. We don't have the variety of products as you might have in Europe or in the US. So that is all we have. And that means there is where the change needs to happen. The next slide, please. Yeah, so first of all, of course, the narrative needs to change. So the corporations have tried to kind of fool the consumers into believing that it's actually our fault that we're in this big mess of plastic pollution, because we are the ones that are trashing the planet. We are the ones that are not recycling properly. Although we know by now that recycling is actually, plastic recycling is a huge lie. So since the 1970s, it has been known that the plastic would never, ever, ever be recycled at such a broad scale as it would need to. And up until today, of all the plastic ever produced, less than 10% has actually been recycled. And most of the plastic, therefore, is still on our planet, because plastic doesn't just biodegrade, it actually breaks down into smaller and smaller pieces. And yeah, it starts to enter the food chain, such as, for example, yeah, it gets eaten by our turtles or other animals, as well as us humans. Next slide, please. So if we're looking at the statistics of where the majority of the plastic is produced, I found that really interesting to look at the stats that Sybil just presented, because I think it aligns very well with what actually, you know, what's produced. You can also see that in the waste that is found in the brand audit. So packaging, food packaging and the likes are actually number one. Also maybe to say, from all the plastic that is produced, about 50% is used for single-use plastic, which is really, really sad. If you think about that, single-use items are really only used for a few seconds, a few minutes, and then end up for hundreds of years in our environment. And when we look now of how much of the proportion of plastic is produced by packaging, we really need to think about, okay, what can be done about that? So corporations obviously are the ones that need to be held responsible. Next slide, please. And it has been talked a lot about what we call the EPR, extended producer responsibility. And of course, it is a little bit overwhelming. I mean, it is great that we have demands such as break free from plastic, and I totally agree with that. But sometimes, you know, we would need legislation to actually enforce those things, or binding treaties by the corporations to really follow suit with what we are demanding. And while we're still waiting for those things to happen, there is a third option that I think is super important, and that is we as the consumers can create demands that the corporations will meet, because they go where the money is. Can we, next slide, please? So, but first of all, we need to become educated consumers, right? So that means we need to know if somebody's trying to bullshit us, as like saying it in plain English, because a lot of the companies are trying to get out of it the easy way, easy fixes, greenwashing a lot of their products, especially the large polluters, because they're not really ready to change just yet. So just as an example, bioplastics is kind of all the new rage. But if you look into the weeds, you know, what does bioplastics actually mean? It doesn't even have like a defined terminology. It can either mean it is biodegradable, or it can mean it is made from a non-petroleum based source, or it can mean both of it. But there is no control over what it actually is. And the sad thing is, you can produce normal plastics such as PETs and PTTs and PAs from, for example, sugarcane or corn, but that doesn't mean that they behave any different in the natural environment. So that means a lot of times, even if you have, in theory, biodegradable plastics such as PLAs, they need actually, and they say it's compostable, they actually need industrial compost. So you can't just like dump them on your home compost, but you have to have really high temperatures and special facilities to break them down. And most communities, for example, in the US, don't even have such a facility. And that means if it would end up in the landfill, or it wouldn't end up in the ocean, it would just behave as any other plastic. Next slide, please. So, and what really gets me really angry is when I hear statements such as that of number one polluter of 2020, Coca-Cola, went to Davos, the World Economic Forum, and actually told publicly that people still want plastic bottles, allegedly, their customers. So that's, I think, the reason that I'm saying, you know what, that is not true. And I think, even though I might like to drink a Coca-Cola every once in a while, I would much rather have it in a sustainable packaging, right? Next slide, please. So that means we need to become really active and responsible in what we're doing and make sure that the companies know what we want. So the first thing is, of course, call them out. That is what the brand audit, for example, is for. Then the next thing, of course, is support legislation and treaties that are aimed at holding companies accountable. And at the next point, well, that, sorry, was actually the other way around. That was the call them out. Next thing. I don't know what's going on. Maybe you can just delete the photo and just so I can go on with the. I'm sorry, my power was gone, so I'm not the one that's managing my own slideshow right now.
I think so, that guy underwater, Christine, is trying to send us a message, do you think?
Maybe. Is this yours, Coca-Cola? I mean, we're definitely finding way too much on that here in Costa Rica as well. Well, and the other big thing that we can do, of course, is boycott products, right? So we don't need to buy that stuff that those companies produce. It is actually a lot better if we would look and support smaller companies with better products, plastic-free products. And the next thing, of course, is we need to talk about it. Oh, sorry, no, actually, that's not the end. So the demand plastic-free alternatives. So if you want to go bigger and not just kind of look at what you're consuming, but look at what your school, your university, your workplace, your local grocery store is selling and offering, the restaurant that you're frequenting, the bar. Because what I've noticed in the past 5 years, especially, is that, you know, there are so many alternatives all of a sudden available. And if I start asking for, I don't know, for example, rice in a paper bag or even bulk products, In a lot of cases, it actually is demanding. It will happen. Eventually, those things will pop up in your local supermarket, for example. And of course, wherever you get the chance, educate people about, you know, what's going on and what they can maybe do better. I think a lot of times, don't try to be too the missionary with the, you know, with a raised finger. But, you know, people a lot of times already start asking you a question when they see that you do things slightly different or when you're demanding certain things. So you can always get a conversation started. Holger, are you stuck? Next one. Cool. And then, of course, lead by example, right? I don't know how many times it has happened already that, you know, just because I have a reusable bag with me, or I'm using a reusable coffee mug, that people started asking me for why I'm doing that. But also, of course, I'm creating a lot less waste, and my consumer power, my dollars going elsewhere than, for example, supporting those large companies. And what I really want to tell everyone, I know that there is a lot of people out there, or maybe not even that many, but it seems like a lot, that, you know, try to be perfectly plastic free, zero waste, all of that. And I think it sometimes intimidates people. So I don't think that anybody needs to be perfect. And I don't want to judge anybody that is unable to do it perfectly, just because circumstances are different. It's also a privilege to live a certain lifestyle. So I just think everyone should do their part, as little or as large as it is. And yeah, Holger, next one. That way we can all be agents of change. So I think what we need to remember is that we vote with our money. So that means where we're spending our money, that means we are supporting those businesses, and those businesses are able to carry on with what they're doing. And hopefully we're able to support businesses that source their materials sustainable and fair, and that actually use genuine plastic-free alternatives. So that means, you know, no greenwashing, but actually are interested of genuinely changing something. And in general, I always recommend to just consume a lot less. We're consuming way too much. And I know that the companies are trying to create a demand with advertising and other stuff. But, you know, living in a country such as Costa Rica has taught me definitely one thing: you can survive and be happy with a lot less than you thought. So definitely consuming less is a big thing. And, you know, changing our habit is really another big thing. So I can challenge you. I mean, that's what I did a few years back. I just looked every month for another item of plastic in my household that I was able to replace with a plastic-free item. And I think over the years, I have already saved quite a few of plastic in my life, and a lot of people that I might have inspired doing the same thing. So don't underestimate your power as an individual, because, you know, you don't know who's watching and you don't know who you inspire with that. And with that, thank you very much.
Hey, Christine, thank you so much there from your car in Costa Rica. Why are you in your car? Are you driving somewhere?
I didn't have power and I needed to find cell phone reception.
That nice and simple explanation. Well, we are a bit over time, so we're going to keep on moving. But let's see if anyone has a question for Christine and you want to ask. Unmute your microphone, tell us your name, where you're from, and ask your question. Anyone have a question for Christine in Costa Rica? If not, because it was a very comprehensive presentation, we'll move on to the next presenter. 5 seconds left. 4, 3, 2, 1. Round of applause for Christine. Thank you so much, Christine. Oh, sorry, Sybil, were you asking a question? I saw you weren't. You're just playing with our emotions. You unmuted your mic and you muted it again. Thank you, Christine. Let's move on now to Laura Degelli. She is in Belgium, and Laura is talking about how the food industry is tackling the global waste problem. So Laura in Belgium, it is over to you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for having me today. I hope you can hear and see me well. It's getting dark here in Belgium, much less exciting than Costa Rica, I guess. So I'm represent Food Drink Europe. We are the organization that represent the European food and drink industry, made 99% of SMEs, and it's the biggest manufacturing sector in Europe. And I will take you through our work to tackle the waste problem, and especially the plastic packaging waste problem. So first of all, I'd like to stress that just over a year ago, the whole sector at European level took or committed to move towards more sustainable food systems. So it was the first time that there was a collective decision and commitment to build more sustainable food systems and to acknowledge our responsibilities, to recognize how much we also will be impacted if we have, if no actions are being taken. And this whole strategy is looking at sustainability as a whole. And we have, for instance, a strong commitment to support the transition to a climate neutral Europe by 2050. And we're developing a roadmap about how we can actually decarbonize our sector. We have a commitment to help halving food waste also by 2030, in line with the sustainable development goal on this matter. We have committed to support the circular economy, and actually a roadmap to a circular economy was developed many years ago already, and we had developed already a roadmap on sustainable packaging more specifically. But I just wanted to stress this collective commitment, which has been taken at sectoral level, which is clearly a sign that there has been a shift of mindset at the sector level. Perhaps just a few words about the political context or why we're doing that and what we are actually doing and what are the different commitments. So first of all, in Europe, and I will be talking mainly about the EU, because that's the sector I read, the level where our sector is operating, even though we have global supply chains, but I'm only familiar with the EU context. But in Europe, we have a very strong and ambitious plastic strategy that was adopted in 2018. And we also have, more recently, the European Green Deal. The European Green Deal includes many different strategies, many different work plans, looking into sustainability in general, the sustainability of the economic system, how to preserve and protect the planet and build a greener world. And part of this European Green Deal is the Circular Economy Action Plan. So we have an ambitious action plan that looks into circularity of different sectors, different products, different chains. And it will include, in particular, the revision of the packaging and packaging waste legislation in the EU, looking into prevention of waste in the first place and going into recycling and keeping materials in the loop as long as possible. And so our sector is fully in line with those commitments and ambitions and support those different strategies. And we are also working to provide input and solutions. So all these also comes with a lot of legal obligations, some more recent than others and some that are upcoming. So we have new obligations that came from the Single-Use Plastics Directive, for instance. So legal obligations to increase collection rates for certain products or design requirements for some products, such as increased recycled content for beverage containers. We have extended producer responsibility schemes expanded to litter cleanup costs, to covering the litter cleanup costs. So there are a lot of legal obligations that have come up with that. But there are also a lot of companies that have made individual pledges or collective pledges and have set up their own commitments. I won't go into the details of those, but among others, we have many companies, many members, sectors or companies that have, for instance, signed up to the New Plastics Economy, the global commitment by the Ellen MacArthur Foundation. We have many members that have also signed up to the European Plastics Pact, or to National Plastics Pact. We have signed up ourselves together with company members and sector members, the Circular Plastics Alliance that works to reincorporate 10 million tons of recycled plastic materials into new products by 2025. And so there are many commitments that have been made either individually, sectorally, together with public or other public and private actors, and some legal obligations. But it's not just setting objectives, setting targets, making commitments, it's also trying out solutions to meet those targets. And there's actually a lot going on. There has been a lot happening, there's a lot happening now, and there's a lot to come as well. And here on that slide, I just put down a few examples of how our members have been putting forward solutions or are trying piloting some solutions. And these go, when it comes to packaging and plastic packaging specifically, it has gone from redesigning the products, the packaging altogether, which has implied for some of them switching from some materials to others that are considered more sustainable for certain applications. So either moving away from plastics or going from multi-material to mono-material packaging that are easier to recycle. It could be also increasing the use of recycled content, going for 100% recyclable packaging. But it has also gone with rethinking the way the products were actually packed, but also delivered to consumers. And we have a lot of members that are also looking into new models of delivery, including here you have the example of Danone that has switched to those glass pots and which is collecting and refilling the yogurt pots for the consumers. So there are a series of examples like that. There are many more than that. And here I've taken a lot of the multinational examples, but of course there are a lot of, there are many more out there. But whatever we do, whatever we try out, whatever we promote or whatever we will be or whatever provisions, legal requirements will be developed, our first and foremost priority is and will always remain to ensure a high level of food safety. And in that case, it's not just ensuring a high level of food safety, but it will also be looking at packaging from a more holistic perspective. So when we look at the packaging we use, we look at the whole, the product and the packaging. So we first think about the product, what it requires, how it's going to be delivered, and whether these products need to have a shelf life of a certain duration, for instance, whether it is, or there are food waste, risks of food waste, for instance. So we are looking at packaging from a more integrated approach than just the environmental aspects of packaging. But of course, the first and foremost priority is safety. And then we need to look at the whole thing with a holistic view and avoid and minimize trade-offs as much as we can, except jeopardizing food safety. And so our sector is convinced that we can build a circular economy for packaging and for plastic packaging in particular. But it requires that the right conditions are in place. And the right conditions include some of those I have put on the slide, but there are of course many others that I haven't mentioned. But first of all, we need to have long-term visibility and legal certainty. So we need to know what is the direction of travel as well of policymakers, for instance, before we or to be able to foster investments, develop innovations, and try out more solutions and develop some solutions more than others. What we are lacking, crucially, in the EU, but I'm pretty sure it's the same globally, is that we're lacking investment, significant investment at European, so regional, but also national level, in waste management infrastructure, which means infrastructure for the collection, sorting, and recycling of packaging waste. And what we also lack is massive investment in recycling technologies. As was mentioned before, currently, apart from PET, there are not that many materials that can be easily recycled. And even if there are some work about new recycling technologies, they are still at the very beginning of the development. So without massive investments in those infrastructure and technologies, we're going to have a hard time to meet the EU ambition for circularity. And this has been recently highlighted in a report by the European Court of Justice too. So it's at least the good thing is that there is awareness now. And so hopefully the new EU budget will actually bring the investments that is very much needed. What we also need in the case of our sector, obviously, is to have rules for the same safe recycling of materials into food contact materials. So you maybe, well, we cannot use in food contact materials any types of recycled content. We need very high level of safety of these materials. So we need to know where the waste comes from. We need to know what is the quality of the recyclates. And to do to ensure the safe recycling of materials into food contact materials, it also requires that you bring together the circularity objectives with the food safety objectives. So it requires adapting the food contact materials legislation and making sure that both the circular economy development are aligned or in work in coherence and consistency with the circularity work. We also need to have strengthened, to develop quality standards and foster markets for secondary raw materials. Currently in Europe, there is not enough recycled materials, especially recycled materials of high quality, to be able to meet even our legal obligations. And we know that it's going to be hard to achieve those if nothing is made. And therefore, we need to foster markets as well for those materials. We need strengthened extended producer responsibility. There's work going on towards strengthening those schemes and harmonizing them as well. But we really need to put more efforts into strengthening EPRs to increase collection and ultimately recycling. We need also definitions of what is recyclable. And I think there's also work expected, and we really have strong hopes about it, so that we clearly know what is recyclable, what are the materials that may be phased out tomorrow, or may be promoted, or what types of format of packaging may be the packaging of the future. And finally, I think it is important to engage consumers in the green transition, which I think is not just help them or empower them to make informed decisions and to play a role, but also have them, as was mentioned before, take an active role in this green transition, sometimes putting pressure on the market, absolutely, and developing partnerships in general, partnerships, cooperation, not just with NGOs, academia, but public and private actors, but with all stakeholders from all the different sectors and all the different supply chains actors. So I think I'll stop here and take any questions before we enter into the debate column. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Laura. Thank you so much for that great debate. Thank you, Laura. And we're a little bit over time, but if anyone does have a question, please unmute your microphone and we'll take one question. Tell us your name and where you're from. If not, we'll take some questions at the end. So if anyone has a question, let us know now. Sybil has her hand up. Sybil, you're so polite with your hand up. Ask your question, please.
Thanks for your presentation. I just wanted to ask a question based on what has been shared in the chat regarding the funding that Food Drink Europe receives from many of the top polluting companies and how that impacts your work.
Yemi? Okay, so our membership is very diverse, and we are funded based on membership fees. And those membership fees come from our membership is made one third of national food and drink federation, like the Estonian Food and Drink Federation, the French one, the German ones, and so on. One third from sector organizations. So that can be the meat sector, the dairy, but it can also be pet food, specialized nutrition, or soft drinks. And then the other side is from companies. That direct, so multinationals mainly. The whole sector otherwise is represented, as I said, 90% of SMEs, and that's altogether 290,000 companies across the EU.
Okay, thank you very much, Sybil. Does that answer your question?
For now.
For now, okay, great. Yeah, no, and it's an interesting thing, and it's something we've discussed before about sometimes what can be the conflict of interest with funding and with agendas and so on and so forth. So it's a good thing to discuss. And I know we just touched on the iceberg there, but we are going to move on because of time, but we have a hot debate at the end. And it's a hot debate that's coming up, trust me. But before we get to the hot debate, we're going to turn back to Tallinn in Estonia to talk to Kerli Kant, because Kerli has a presentation, Whose Responsibility is Textile Waste? Producer's Role in the Transition Towards Circular Textile Industry. So Kerli, this is a fascinating area because there is so much waste in the textile industry, and it's over to you. That desktop, Kerli, is giving me anxiety. Look, you need to sort out that desktop, first of all.
Hello, everybody. Well, there is a half of me is academic, so I hope I'm excused for that.
You're excused.
Yeah. So nice to be with everyone. And I was invited to bring in the textile perspective into this conversation. And so my name is Kerli. I have two hats on. I run my own consultancy, Revaluate, where I work with kind of an ecosystem in textiles, trying to implement and develop circular solutions, mainly in the Baltic Nordic region, but also internationally. And then secondly, since last week, I have a hat on of Estonian Business School, where I started as a circular economy lead. And my my experience with textiles is more than 10 years, both in practice, but also academia. I did a research as a PhD on business model innovation for circular economy, where I worked with a big Nordic fashion corporation on the topic how to integrate the reuse and recycling aspects into the existing business model. And that was actually, it started before the term circular economy was even widely used. And beside the corporate work, I have also worked and also today working with nonprofits, with collectors, sorters, reuse, recycling organizations, and also with startups. So I'm a systems thinker and I'm a circularity advocate. And my kind of expertise is on the post-consumer waste fraction. So the products that exist, how to prolong the life of those and how to collect them, reuse, recycle, and then get the fibers back in the productions. So textiles has become one of the bad boys next to plastics. And the reason is there is too much production, too much consumption. Products are losing quality, so there is a low quality issue. There are lacking systems of collections, limited reuse practices, and lack of recycling technologies. And this picture illustrates the kind of the elephant in the room, which is a fast fashion. This has been a growing trend since the last two decades. And the report from Ellen MacArthur Foundation, I mean, there is a lot of research popping up these days on textiles, and which is great, but I think the Ellen MacArthur Foundation illustrates it kind of in a global perspective, that the consumption has doubled, the production and consumption has doubled, that's the black line, over the last 15 years. At the same time, if you look at the green line, then the use of clothes, we are using them one third less than we used to. So the volume is growing and the use phase is going down. And that creates the waste problem. If we look at the material flow chart here, then from the left, all the material that goes in. And as you can see, plastics is today in the fiber. Global fiber picture is 63%, cotton is only 26%, and the plastic or the synthetics fibers are growing. So does the blend of materials, which is a complicated issue at the end of life practices. And if we look at the end part on the right, the 73%, that's all the textiles that don't get collected for reuse and recycling or recycling. And when we look at the red circle on the up there, 1%, less than 1% closed loop recycling, then this is the fiber to fiber, getting the new clothes into, or old clothes into new clothes. So we have we have a waste problem and we don't have solutions today enough to actually circulate all these materials back into the economy. And then, so what are the brands and producers, retailers? I've kind of put them in the same hat today because they are the ones who are kind of in between the brands, in between the consumers and the production. And what is their role? They have a huge role. And as you can see on this picture, this is, by the way, taken in one of the exclusive department stores in Copenhagen. And in my eyes, this is the products have already turned into waste in the store. So it's kind of difficult to take these brands or department stores kind of circularity or sustainability claims seriously if this is the picture you see when you enter in the store. They don't value products. And when we talk about circular economy, then value is in the center. So what is the role of brands, retailers, fast fashion companies? So they are the designers of waste or value, depending what is the relationship with the products. Is it for 3 times use? Is it 30 times use? They are also the textile value chain managers. Brands have the power. They have the power both upstream and downstream. They are the gatekeepers between products and consumers. So they have a powerful position to influence what consumers buy, how they buy, how they consume them, and also to actually collect them back for reuse and recycling. They are circular consumption facilitators. Again, through their business models, they can facilitate more sustainable consumption practices. Do they, for example, as you can see on the picture, Nudie Jeans, one of the Swedish denim brands, they are offering repair services for their products. And they have done that for years and it's very structured. It's a well-accessed service. And if you don't live nearby, you can actually order the repair kit yourself and with guidelines and you can try to repair your jeans yourself. So through the kind of business models or business model innovations, brands can engage with consumers on different ways, how to first what to buy, how to use it, how to reuse it, and what to do with it at the end of their life. And I also put here educators because brands have the position to take a step further, not just what the consumers want, but to take a responsibility to become a stewards, take the stewardship. And what do they to kind of guide and provide the knowledge, educate the consumers on more sustainable practices. And there are not so many brands who do that, but some examples, and this is kind of authentic and dedicated. I will bring one example in the end as well. So quickly, so from the brand perspective, how to go about the circularity and waste issue, there is a linear value chain and all the circles and activities, what the brand should address on from their own business model perspective. I know we don't have much time, so I'm not going to go in detail here. And since the focus today was greenwashing, then we can see a lot of greenwashing these days around textiles and fashion. And it's very difficult for consumers to actually navigate what is a sustainable fashion, what is a piece of sustainable fashion. It doesn't have a clear quantifiable definition, so companies cannot be held accountable for their actions either. So we see all kinds of interesting communications around green claims. There is also lack of mainstream public awareness. What actually happens in the production phase, but also what happens with a ready used clothes. So we need to raise the public awareness around these issues. And third, as or third aspect I wanted to raise is the fragmented landscape of certifications and eco-labels. Again, consumers are quite confused. If a T-shirt is organic, using organic cotton, is it a sustainable piece of garment? If it costs €2 and after two washes is out of shape, then definitely not. This is a sustainable or circular product. And there is lack of expertise and know-how, meaning that also brands and corporations, some brands I've been working with, they simply don't know better. So in-house expertise is lacking. It's a complex field, and they just don't know how to do better. And this is a good example. So as I said, brands can be a very strong communicators and facilitators and educators. And this is one of my darlings when it comes to best practices. It's a US female brand, Eileen Fisher, and they have already more than 10 years collected back their used products. And why I brought this example here is the window message. And I think this is very strong and powerful, that we'd like our clothes back now. Thank you very much. So they value the products and they ask the customers to value the products. So when you return the Eileen Fisher used product to them, they give you a $5 voucher that you can use in the original store or buying a new product. And this is, of course, questionable if this is a good thing to stimulate the purchase of new. But what they do with these products, they clean, they repair, they redesign, and they resell again. And they do it very seriously and with a very strong communication. Time is running. I know we have one more speaker, a very interesting speaker, so I'm gonna stop here. I hope that quick helicopter view brought the textile perspective to the panel here. And I'm happy to discuss and take questions if there are any. Thank you.
Curly, thank you very much for that. Curly in Estonia. And interesting you mentioned nudie jeans, because these jeans I'm wearing now are nudie jeans. The name nudie jeans. And I lived in New York for 5 years and I often saw the store down in Lower Manhattan, the nudie jean repair store. So fantastic. Anyone have any question? Before we move on to our last speaker before our hot debate, if you have a question, unmute your microphone, tell us your name, where you're from, and the floor is all yours.
Maybe I have a question. It's me again, Carl from Hamburg.
Hey, and Carl from Hamburg.
I've observed that we are, since a few months or maybe even years, we have lesser and lesser containers for collecting old clothes because people were littering them and misusing them. And I would like to hear maybe from an expert, is this a global issue or only here in Hamburg?
I think now, I don't know so well about Germany, but I think it's a local problem because we are moving towards collecting more and more. And the EU has the regulation that from 2025, all EU countries has to collect textiles separately from the municipal waste. So there has to be textile collection systems in place. And I think more and more cities, if we look at Scandinavia, for example, they are putting more containers, they are piloting new ways of collections, new collaborations. So we will be seeing more collection and hopefully also in Hamburg. So ask your local.
Yeah, we put pressure on them.
Yeah, but
good
but
to know that we are.
But the reason is also that the quality is going down. So perhaps these organizations that used to collect them and were earning money from reuse, they just couldn't make money anymore. And they
that's the problem. Business. Yeah, the quality of what is giving back is too low to make money with it. Yeah. And the littering too. Okay. Thank you.
Good question. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Hamburg, and thank you very much again, Curly, there in Estonia. We're going to move on now to our final speaker. We're going to Gunter Pali, who is in Japan. And Gunter, I know, has taken part in the conference before. And the topic up for discussion, time to go beyond the cleanup the errors of the past and create a society that takes us to the future. So Gunter, with pleasure, we'll hand over to you now.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Actually, I'm not in Japan. I'm for the moment in Bogota, Colombia.
Wow.
So feeling close, but I'm leaving for Europe on Monday, and in 2 weeks I'll be back in Japan. Look, the problems of plastics have been known since the 70s. It's like tobacco. We knew it. We covered it up. We claimed we're doing things. We're doing pilot projects here and there. And ladies and gentlemen, let's be very frank. Statistics go in the totally wrong direction. Totally wrong direction. I mean, let's look at the plans of Shell. They have just opened in Indiana the largest plastic production center, 1 million tons, and 12 new 1 million ton production centers of plastics are being built as we speak. So what are we doing? I mean, we're gonna have plastics all the way up to there and beyond. So let me talk to you about the real problem. The problem is not just having biodegradable plastics. The problem is to have a sustainable production and consumption system. And we don't have it. And as long as we try to decrease the present level, then we are doing less bad. Let me be very clear. Polluting less is polluting. Stealing less is stealing. Okay? So when we are doing less bad, we're doing bad. It's time to do good. And I think it is urgent that we look the reality in the eye and start declaring the real problem of plastics, which is not just the packaging, which is not just the textiles. It is the microplastics that are even found today in the placenta of a baby's mother's womb. I mean, come on. Let's wake up. It's not about the plastic you find on a beach and you do your beach cleanups. It's about microplastics, the size of perhaps 1 micron, that invades and permeates everything in life. And so as long as we don't wake up and shake up, nothing is going to go. And what goes is way too slow. When my dear friend Ellen MacArthur declared 3 years ago at the World Economic Forum that in 2020 and 2050, we will have more plastics than fish, she forgot to say that she defined plastics only till 0.5 millimeter. Because if we include plastics from 1 micron to 0.5 millimeter, ladies and gentlemen, we have dozens of times more plastic particles in the ocean than we have fishes today. So the problem has not been really confronted with real action. We have too many declarations, we have great initiatives, but we need to start turning the statistics. And when we're looking at the reality of the statistics, let's add one major complexity. So I'm saying it's not just plastics, it is particularly microplastics. But second, inside the plastics, we have additives no one is talking about. And the additives include, for example, ultraviolet blockers. That means, are we putting ultraviolet blockers in microplastics that will now permeate even into the placenta of a baby that gives us 3,000 to 8,000 microparticles from a PET bottle of drinking water? I mean, we have forgotten that the additives like UV blockers and fire retardants are now being integrated in the full cycle of life because they've been designed not to degrade. I mean, can you imagine? Not to degrade in fire and not to degrade in the sun. Look, we've made this a bit more too difficult, and therefore we need real initiatives. And that means that we need to create not just a biodegradable plastic, because I know biodegradability is not the solution. It is perhaps a contribution. But biodegradation, let's look at the definition of biodegradation. Biodegradation means it degrades in the soil. What about the sea? Now, we've forgotten that salt is a conservation agent. So whenever you put a plastic into the sea, it is withering down and it's being conserved as minor particles. Shocking. I mean, how come there is no university in the world, not one university in the world, teaching the chemical engineers as an obligatory course to learn how to degrade plastics in the soil, in the sun, and in the sea? Shocking. I mean, the European Union with their Green Deal, why was there not one line in the Green Deal saying every chemical engineer who graduates will know how to design a molecule that will degrade in the sun, the soil, and the sea? We don't do it. So we do not need more education. We need inspiration. We need to get down to concrete projects that are really transformative. And the transformative side is to demystify a plastic in the first place. What is a plastic? Well, plastics are made in nature all the time. Plastics is a polymer that in the end can be made out of an oil and a sugar. So I'm chairman of a company called Novamont, and we're taking oil from a non-edible plant that is growing as a weed. It's called the thistle. I mean, thistles are fought with glyphosates to kill them off, but thistles, they create a nice oil, which is comparable to the sunflower oil. You turn that into an acid, and then you have a sugar we turn into an alcohol and an acid together gives you a monomer, and monomers are turned into polymers. It is so goddamn easy that we can actually democratize again the production of plastics by having any region in the world that has excess sugars and excess oils, vegetable oils, just to do this. Now, I'm seeing that there is just biodegradability not in the soil. And I know it is a complex definition, but let me go back to the very clear point. Biodegradation. I was the first producer of biodegradable detergents. I was the chairman and the CEO of Ecover, and we created the factory that was, even as a factory, biodegradable. But I was using palm oil. And clearly, palm oil is biodegradable, but certainly not sustainable. So we need to go beyond the definition of biodegradable and what is defined as biodegradable today. We need to go to the actions, and these actions need to be plastic free from farm to fork, from crop to cup. We need to have clear initiatives that allow us to do that. So let me summarize with two very simple proposals. First of all, nature is our inspiration. We are putting in place a microplastic cleanup system that imitates the way lungs work. And we can take micron plastic sizes out of the water, and we can do it today. Why is the industry not acting? Why is it not doing? Because we need to correct the errors of the past. But second, we need to create the future. And the future is clearly going to be based on generating a decentralized system of collecting those excesses of sugar, which can be from straw, from oils, and turn these into the bioplastics that are not just biodegradable, but also sustainable. The technologies are there. We know it. But what we now need is fast and blunt action beyond what we have seen today. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much for those inspirational words, Gultur Pali there. And I like that you're in the bushes, you're in the trees, outdoors, surrounded by nature. Well, now at this point, we are going to have a hot topic debate. And wrong sound effect. We have some flames and fire there because this is a hot debate. And we're rejoined by Sybil, Christine, by Laura, by Carolee. And we're also joined by Margot as well and by Gunter. So the question is to blame or to cooperate corporations. Do you blame them? Do you shame them? Or do you work with them and try and change them and go hand in hand? Gunter, very quickly, do we blame or do we shame?
No, we're not blaming, not shaming. We're inspiring entrepreneurs to start a new competitive model and the entrepreneurs that will go for the common good. We need to have a new business model, and that means drastic transformation of what we do now. We need entrepreneurs, first and foremost.
Okay, Sybil, I know this is something that you feel strongly about. Let's do it world, great organization, Earth Day, great organization. All these organizations need funding to do what they want to do. So when a company comes along to offer funding, but maybe they're one of the polluters as well, what do you do?
It's definitely tricky. I think there's a certain amount of bias inherent in the question, the way it's framed. I think you don't have to shame, but you do have to be clear about the source of the problem. And if you're an organization, like I'm in the NGO sector as well. Like, of course, it's not a very solid financial model. But when you accept funding from a polluting company, you have to be really cautious of being co-opted by that funding source. So when you accept funding, that's a source of power that will potentially compromise and influence your integrity and the type of work that you're able to do.
Do you think it happens a lot within organizations who are trying to do good work and trying to do environmental cleanups and so on? I'm talking in general.
It happens a lot, yes. Actually, may I recommend, there's a whole chapter about this in this amazing book by Naomi Klein called This Changes Everything. So many giant environmental organizations, the Nature Conservancy, like so many groups, need money and they collaborate with fossil fuel companies, and it significantly influences their narrative, their message, the way that they work, and just waters down our potential to really make long-term change if we're bickering amongst each other like this.
The old saying, he who pays the piper calls the tune. Well, let's bring in Margot Lure from Speak Smart. Margot, what do you think? The question here on my screen is, to blame or to cooperate?
I've actually been taking notes throughout the presentations, thank you to all the presenters. It's been very interesting to follow. I would point to some of the things that came out in the presentations, which are, at least to me, they seem like contradictions, and I'd love to hear if the panelists also think it's a contradiction and what would be the possible solution to the contradiction. So on the one hand side, I heard from Laura that food safety is paramount, and recyclables simply are not ready to come into contact with food and therefore cannot be used in food packaging, for example. And then I heard, Christine, who was saying that there are good examples of how we can move beyond plastic packaging and do so safely. Also, we heard from Gerli, who was saying that there's an increasing amount of synthetic fibers in the textiles industry, while Gunther was saying how easy it is to create completely plastic-free materials. So it would be really good to hear what the solutions are to some of these, at least to me, seeming contradictions.
That's a good point, Margot. So let's go back to your first one. You were saying that, Laura said that we're not at a stage yet where recyclable materials can come into contact with food for packaging on a mainstream mass basis. And then that was contradicted by Christine. So Laura, back to you. The science isn't there yet. They haven't proven that it's completely safe to replace the current packaging that's in mainstream use with a new kind of recyclable packaging. Is that kind of the very basic argument?
I think in the EU, we have a legislation on materials in contact with food. And one piece, well, it's a legislative framework, which includes a piece on plastics in contact with food. And there's another piece on recycled plastic materials in contact with food. So it's all very strictly regulated. What we are lacking today, however, is that we have the European Food Safety Agency that is meant to approve recycling processes as being safe or as being able to provide materials that are safe enough to be used in contact with food without having to go through a check for each and every time you want to use a material. And currently there are more than, I think, 150 dossiers for PET recycling that are still in the pipeline for authorization. And we are far from having anything happening for other materials than PET. And so indeed, in the EU, what we have as an issue as the food and drink industry is that we don't have enough supply and we don't have the certainty about the safety of the materials. We know that we have also a lot of members who have pledged to use more recycled content and that have to buy recycled materials from outside Europe. Does that make sense from a circular economy perspective and for the environment altogether to import your recycled materials in order to meet your target? That's also a question that some of our members are asking. And recycling in the EU is still a very marginal activity. And there, as I said, like less than half of plastic packaging waste is being recycled today in the EU. That's far, far from being enough. And without, as I said before, without the investment into the infrastructure and the technologies, but also the acceleration of the food safety process, we are far from being able to achieve our objectives within the next years. So if we want to be serious about the ambition to 2030, as far as the EU is concerned, we have to accelerate investments, accelerate those developments and work together towards the same goals.
And Laura, I know this might be a difficult question to answer, but is there like a time frame? If someone had come up with a new type of packaging they thought was recyclable and was safer to use or whatever, is it months, is it years? How does it get through those processes and ticks to be able to be used by restaurants and takeaways?
It very much depends on the companies, I believe. They all have their innovation cycles, their production cycles as well. And I think what matters, and as I put in my presentation, is to have also certainty about the direction of travel, especially, for instance, from policymakers, to be able to plan ahead your investments, your innovations, and make sure that, because no companies would actually spend money into innovation if they don't know that these innovations will be welcome or will be killed in just 2 years' time. Mm. So there's a lot of forward looking that needs to be there and to provide the certainty that is needed.
Gunter, what do you think of that thought that, okay, well, you know, all of us are here, want to get rid of plastics, but even like with the food industry, it's not all being approved as safe, recyclable materials. It probably will take a long time. The motivation isn't there for the companies because they might work on something in their R&D department, and then it gets blocked by policy after they spent all this money on it and wasted. So why change it? Plastics, there's still a huge demand. They're here to stay for a while.
Look, food packaging is one of the very typical examples where you have always multi-layers. You have a paper, you have a plastic, because you need to have a barrier of oxygen, you need to have a barrier of water, of humidity. And so what to me is very clear, we at Novamont, we've developed a multi-layer, but of one polymer only. Now, let me be very frank with you. Getting an approval in Europe for a new type of food packaging, contact with food, is years and millions. Let's not dream about it. The European Union is an instrumentation that blocks many of these innovations. That's one of the reasons why we are very particularly at working in countries where it goes fast, where when you're using raw materials from nature only, when you use zero solvents, when you use zero additives in the chemicals, you are treated as if you are a chemical problem with a lot of toxic inclusions. And that is something where the European Union has become a blocking agent instead of a promoter. You know, to me, it is key. The science is there. The knowledge is there. It's the vested interests that are blocking way too much. And that is something we do not need to take time to expose it. We just need to put it aside. And what we're doing with our new initiative, which is called Porima, with our new initiative, we want to inspire young people to take initiatives, not just to be against, but to ensure that what is much better gets to the market much faster.
What do you think, Sybil? We'll give you another chance to input into this because I know you're fiery about this and you're passionate about it. What do you think about what you're hearing?
I kind of want to just share a really powerful visual that I think helps a lot when we're kind of getting in the nitty-gritty details of this discussion. If you imagine an oil spill, like an oil spill in the ocean, for example, BP oil spill, Exxon Valdez oil spill. The companies that are behind this oil spill are legally and financially responsible for cleaning it up and paying for the damages. Plastic as a material is 99% fossil fuel. So in that regard, plastic pollution is basically an oil spill. It's essentially the same raw material, and it's got a lot of similar elements as an oil spill. It's nearly impossible to clean up once it gets to the stage of microplastics. It's extremely toxic for our human health, for wildlife. And the reason that we're all locked into this problematic system is because there's extremely powerful vested interests and multi-billion dollar companies that want us to stay addicted to this material and this single use model. So I think that we're being extremely taken advantage of when we have a bunch of well-intentioned, idealistic, great people who are being, you know, misled into these short-term solutions that are not addressing the source. So oil spills and plastic pollution are essentially one and the same, and they should be legally treated one and the same.
What did you say? There were Sybil, naive, well-meaning people?
I grew up as one of them. Like, well-intentioned idealists.
Not in their defense, but if the EU were here now, I am sure what they would argue is that, look, we have got such a responsibility over the health and well-being of an entire continent and all countries, we simply can't rush something through. Like in the pharmaceutical world, something goes in clinical trial normally before COVID for years. We can't just put this packaging through until we have tested it again and again and again, until we are 1,000% sure that it is safe. And let's bring in Christine on this as well. Christine, what do you think about what you're hearing? Of course, you famously became known all over the world, that photograph you took of pulling a plastic straw out of a turtle's nose, which was extraordinary. What do you think of what you're hearing?
Yeah, I think, I mean, from my experience, it's just that, first of all, the shame or blame question, I think it's not, we're not going to solve the problem if we don't get everybody on the same page. And I think sometimes people forget that even large corporations are made up of people that, you know, sometimes really have good intentions and are just against like a huge other interests. And I mean, I agree with most of what Sybil says, and you know, that we need to inform people better in order to make better decisions, and we need to hold them accountable, but we also need to provide feasible alternatives. So working with Footprint, I just kind of listen in a lot of the conversations that they have with some of the really large companies, and the problem is usually you need a product that is scalable. So are you able to produce for a McDonald's, for example, the billion and billion of units that they would need to source out their plastic? Second of all, of course, they want to make money. So, I mean, we're not going to lie about it. We're not going to stop them from doing that. So that means we need alternatives that are actually the same, at least in cost, and not more of what they're paying right now, because not if they're going to stick to plastics. And then, of course, yeah, legislation is important. We would need many countries to step up and force them to clean up their mess. But that might work in the EU, that might work in the US. But if I'm looking at smaller countries such as Costa Rica, they will never, ever, ever be able to go against such large corporations for other interests. I mean, they usually provide work and other things to the country that are way too important to kind of, you know, yeah, get them angry or like turn them against you. So I think, I don't know, I think we're not going to solve the problem with one initiative. So I always kind of have to smile when people say, oh, we are the one initiative that will solve all our problems. I don't believe that. I think everyone in this fight has their space and their place. And yeah, we need more ideas. We need feasible alternatives, but we also need to think about of how are we meeting the needs of those large corporations that will continue to make money. So in the end, I think it's a super complex problem. And I think there is a lot of genius heads already at work that are trying to fix it. So I don't think the panel today will fix it, to be quite honest. But I'm always, you know, I'm always interested to hear what is going on elsewhere, right? And I'm always super psyched to hear that so many people from different perspectives and different angles are tackling the problem, because that's really what we need.
Great answer. And the name of the question was to blame or to cooperate. So I want to ask the final question very quickly to Gunter before we wrap this up. So Gunter, you are a great speaker, inspirational speaker, so passionate about this, and you're well known all over the globe. So let's say Coca-Cola come to you and they say, Gunter, we at Coca-Cola, we find your talks inspirational. We want to sponsor a world tour. You can go around and give your talks to universities and schools. We'll sponsor it. Would you get into bed with Coca-Cola?
Never. We have a world tour with our hydrogen and our solar ship planned for 2125. We refuse any sponsor. We refuse them. We need to be genuine in our heart. And we know that today there are quite different ways of financing, so you don't have to go in bed with them. No. But I'm always saying to the Coca-Colas who do contact me, and the Shells and the Unilevers who do contact me, that I'm not against them. I want something that is so much better that they can even imagine. I mean, let's look at Nestlé. The best they could do in 2020 was to have a paper wrapping around small packs of Kit Kat. The Kit Kat was still wrapped in the same old packaging, but then it was a paper pack. And they said, look what we're doing. And I said, you gotta be kidding, you guys. I mean, this is greenwashing. And let me be very straightforward. I was one time invited by sustainable brands, and I pushed point by point, company by company, that was their sponsor, how disastrous they are and how greenwashing they were doing. Of course, I was never invited by sustainable brands again. And I don't mind that, but we need to be very clear that a new generation of entrepreneurs is needed, and not just the new technology, because the business model has to change.
But Gunter, maybe it's easier for you because you are well known and you've built up a network of resources and you can fund projects in different ways. But what about for smaller groups who do need funding to pay for the hotel, to have the conference, to fly someone in to speak? They need money. And when a company comes, because on these corporate boards of all these big companies, they love to have in their corporate whatever booklet at the end of the year that they've done something sustainable. So, I mean, it's difficult not to take the money to be able to do what you're passionate about, because it will push your cause further a bit.
It will not. I always saying the best entrepreneurs are the entrepreneurs who don't have money and don't have experience. And these are the preconditions to be real innovators. And I have created more than 200 projects around the world in the last 25 years. And I know it's always a fight to get it. But on another platform and another time, we can talk about how to create your own NGO, your own company without money and without experience. But that's the precondition to succeed in the transformation we need.
Well, Gunter, on that great note, with the sun shining up brightly on you, we'll leave it there. And thank you for your time. I think we might have time for maybe one question, or if anyone wants to put an input or say something that we've missed, you can. I know there's so much we could still get to, but unmute your microphone, say your name and where you're from and your comment or question.
Jim, Estonia.
Oh, hey, Jim. Yes, go for it.
It's a question to Gunter. Hello, Gunter. Long time no see. I was listening to your speech earlier saying that what we need is fast action. And you're talking about entrepreneurs and changing the economic model. And I agree that action needs to be fast, but can you tell us one solid, concrete action that will make a huge difference, like tomorrow?
The first and the foremost thing we have to do is every day we have to tell a positive, inspiring story to children, not talk about the problems, not talking about the ways, but we need to talk about inspiring the next generation. And so if you and I, and everyone around this, promises that from today on, every day, we tell a positive story, an inspiring story based on science, based on what you could do, I guarantee you, we will change the world. Storytelling. That's where we have to start every day.
Storytelling. Thank you so much, Gunter. Thank you, Jim. And thank you, everybody. We're out of time. We're over time, in fact. And I hope you all enjoyed the session. I think you'll agree. Great speakers. So everyone give each other a round of applause there. Sorry for the cheesy music, but I mean, you got to do it. So thank you to all of our speakers today who took part in the debate and who spoke individually, and to you for your questions and for listening. This is the Let's Do It World Conference. Enjoy the rest of the sessions today, and I will see you later. I'll see you tomorrow. Thank you. Bye-bye.